You don't have to relinquish the chair.
The Subcommittee on Indian and Insular and Alaska Native Affairs will come to order. The Subcommittee is meeting today to hear testimony on the inadequate standards for trust acquisition in the Indian Reorganization Act of 1934. Under Committee Rule 4F, any oral opening statements at the hearings are limited to the chairman and the ranking minority member and the vice chair and a designee of the ranking member. This will allow us to hear from our witnesses sooner and help members keep to their schedules. Therefore, I ask unanimous consent that all other members' opening statements be made part of the hearing record if they are submitted to the subcommittee clerk by 5 p.m. today or close of the hearing, whichever comes first. Hearing no objections, so ordered. I'll also ask unanimous consent to allow our colleague from Oklahoma, Congressman Tom Cole, our colleague from Minnesota, Congressman Betty McCollum, and our colleague from California, Congressman Jared Huffman, to be seated with the subcommittee on the dais and participate in today's hearing. Hearing no objection, so ordered.
I thank you, Mr. Denham, for opening this meeting, and I'm sorry I'm a little late. I think he's covered this meeting, and he'll cover many subjects today. I'd like to add to my opening statement one thing, if I may. Anything we do concerning Carciere, I want to make sure that it's understood it will not have a conflict with previous laws, especially for Alaska. I've told Mr. Cole we're going to have a clean bill. As long as the administration comes down with the idea that they will not interfere with subservice versus service rights. That's crucial to my state and the Native corporations. So with that, I'll recognize the good gentleman, the ranking member, for an opening statement.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. The topic today is indeed important, and we will hear more appropriately from two colleagues, Ms. McCallum and Mr. Cole, relative to their legislations, which I support. It's the good legislations to fix Carciere. And the discussion today needs to be a discussion that talks about where we go from here and how we fix. With that, I have a statement. If there's no objection, we'll enter that into the record. With that, I yield back.
Without an objection, so entered. No other opening statements. Mr. Cole, you want to say something now or you want to ask questions?
I was told, Mr. Chairman, that we'd have an opportunity to make a statement and then we would not participate in the question.
Either way, whatever you'd like to do.
We'd prefer, I think, to both make a statement and then allow the committee to go about its business.
And then, Mr. Cole, you're recognized.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, Mr. Ranking Member. I really appreciate you holding this hearing today on what I think is an exceptionally important topic. I'll have prepared remarks that are going to be submitted later today. I appreciate the committee's indulgence and cooperation in that. It's been very, very helpful. And I'm here in my capacity. I think my good friend Ms. McCollum's here in her capacity as co-chairman of the Native American Caucus to express our concerns and opinions about the Indian Recognition Act of 1934. Just to be clear up front, we oppose any repeal or significant modification of the Indian Recognition Act 1934. We would favor strengthening the Secretary's authority to put land into trust. We believe the obvious fix for that is legislation that Ms. McCollum has a bill, I have a bill, we actually co-sponsor one another's bill. We think either of them would be an appropriate vehicle to resolve this thorny dilemma. We approach this with the traditional view of the nature of the relationship between Native American nations and the United States government. While we recognize states and localities may have views and interests and they ought to be taken into consideration, the Constitution, the law, and jurisprudence is awfully clear that the relationship with Indian nations is solely the province of the federal government. Other people don't have any authority here. They can express a view, but they shouldn't have any formal role in the process of recognition. The purpose of the Indian Regulatory Act was to stop the erosion of the tribal landmass, which had been going on in the, over the preceding half century. From 1887 to 1934, the Indian landmass shrank from 138 million acres to 48 million acres. And the Dawes Act and the allotment process that spearheaded that was opposed by every single Indian tribe. This is not a policy that was advocated by Indians for Indians. This was a policy that Indians at the time violently opposed, and because they understood what the consequences were going to be. Just as most tribes, frankly, every tribe I know would oppose any effort to repeal or significantly modify the Indian Recognition Act. The Indian Recognition Act has actually done what it was supposed to do. It stopped that erosion at 48 million. We've modestly grown the land base back to 56 million acres or so. And in an appropriate, thoughtful, step-by-step way, secretaries of both parties and all administrations until the Carcieri decision looked at these decisions and I think made the appropriate decision. And by way of historical background. I had the opportunity to read the background statement, and I want to take issue, and I want to do this very respectfully, with a couple of things, just to inform the committee of at least the way I personally look on this issue. It says in the document, allotment had a humane basis. Congress and activists wanted to convert impoverished Indians living on tribal communal property into property-owning farmers and ranchers who would presumably assimilate in the Western economy. The act failed because many Indians did not adjust or were not taught to adjust to the radical shift in their culture, economy, and lifestyle. That's just not true. That is a misstatement of historical reality. And I know this firsthand because my family went through this process. So the record is awfully clear, and I would commend to the committee, if you want to understand at least what happened in Oklahoma, there's a wonderful book by Angie DeBow called And Still the Waters Run, which is the classic treatment of this, and it makes it awfully evident. The Indians in Oklahoma were neither impoverished nor backward. They were actually more progressive. They had their own governments, their own written languages, their own territory. They were all opposed to what happened to them. And the Dawes Commission was an egregious violation of every treaty that the United States had signed. The Indian Reorganization Act was an effort to reverse that awful and tragic mistake. Let me end up and be very personal here. My great-great-grandfather, when he was 14 years old, walked 800 miles to Indian Territory, became the chief clerk of the Supreme Court before there was a territory of Oklahoma. His son, my great-grandfather, became the treasurer of the nation before there was a state of Oklahoma. And my great-grandfather, involved in the allotment process, the decisions that had to be made in terms of trying to preserve what could be saved. And my grandparents went through this process. What happened was my brother and I owned the last of our allotment land. But what happened on ground, whatever the intentions of a few idealistic reformers in Washington, was the systematic stripping away of land from individuals. I'll give you two personal examples. My grandmother and my great-grandfather always warned her, don't marry a white man. Probably pretty good advice in the early part of the 20th century. She ignored that. One of her sisters ignored that. In the case of my grandmother, married a guy. He immediately sold the land, immediately divorced her, and gone. The other one just didn't bother with the divorce. He just disappeared. And that happened case after case after case. That is why the Congress of the United States intervened appropriately in 1934 to stop this from happening. And it happened all over Indian country to all kinds of tribes. So as you approach this, I would hope that we do what we did not do in 1887. We actually listened to tribal nations. Usually Indians know what's best for Indians, and they have repeatedly told us this was not the way to go then, don't reverse this now. And again, they're awfully united in asking that either Ms. McCollum's bill or my bill or some combination of the two be advanced so that the ability of the secretary, judiciously used, to put land into trust will be strengthened and recognized again. Right now, the secretary, whoever that individual is, has the unenviable task of frankly trying to administer between two different kinds of Indian tribes, one that they can put land into trust for, another group that they cannot. That simply creates a group of second-class Indian tribes, not the intent. It's a bad judicial decision by the Supreme Court, with all due respect to the body, ought to be reversed. But anyway, the position of our caucus is very strongly in defense of the Indian Recognition Act and the appropriate modification with a carcerary fix. So thank you for your indulgence, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for holding a hearing on this really important topic.
Thank you, Mr. Cole, and thank you for your knowledge of this issue. As time goes by, as we look at this proposal, I hope to have your input, and Ms. McCollum, your input, and you're recognized now to make your comment.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair, and the ranking members of the subcommittee.
Turn that mic on.
I have a terrible voice. Excuse me. Mr. Cole, listen to me cough all day in a markup. I'm very pleased to join you here today to discuss trust and land acquisition for tribal nations. As one of the co-chairs of the Congressional Native Caucus, I truly mean it when I say my good friend Congressman Cole and I worked together in a bipartisan fashion to help this body live up to our trust and treaty obligations throughout Indian country. An important part of the work that we do is to amplify the voices of tribal leaders that are coming before the subcommittee today to say that the title and proposed intent of this hearing is causing significant alarm among tribal leaders. Mr. Chair, as you know firsthand, as a great advocate for American Indians and Alaska Natives, the Indian Reorganization Act passed in 1934 put an end to the disastrous impolicy of an unallotment for Indian lands. And I could tell many stories of what happened with the lumber barons to the Ojibwe, Chippewa nations in my state of Minnesota. Any serious discussion of land into trust process must be rooted in the knowledge that the IRA was intended to help tribes restore land base for their sovereign nations. Because in the allotment period, about 90 million acres, nearly two-thirds of the lands promised to the tribes in treaties and statutes, was taken away by the federal government. The IRA's goal is to help tribal nations rebuild their government, their economies, and most importantly, their communities, which were devastated by this unallotment policy. Restoring this land base through land trust acquisition was and remains today an essential means of healing tribal communities and promoting self-governance. Thus, I would encourage the subcommittee to work on land trust acquisition to remain focused on our shared goal of promoting tribal self-determination. And from that perspective, I want to clearly state my strong support of the current process for taking land into trust. Regulations have provided a balanced, transparent, and structured process to guide the authority of the Secretary of Interior, state, local, and other tribal governments so that everyone is given a role and their interests are weighed in all decisions. I would like to state my objection to the characterization of the standards of the process for trust to land as somehow inadequate or unregulated. They are, as a matter of fact, very conservative. Less than 10% of the total land taken in allotment period has been restored to tribal nations through land and trust acquisition. And despite the occasional controversies and disputes that will arise with any land use policy, the vast majority of land to trust transactions are uncontroversial. They typically involve land for housing, health clinics, schools, and agriculture. And these are advances that we should be supporting, not restricting. Mr. Chairman, I would like to present to you that the biggest problem currently facing the land to trust process is not a matter of standards, but it's a matter of fairness to tribes, as Mr. Cole pointed out. Tribes that have been recognized since 1934, due to a stunning misrepresentation of congressional intent by the U.S. Supreme Court and carcerary decision, these tribal nations have had their right to place land into trust called into question, and that's just wrong. It's a mistake that Congress must and could easily correct. Any and all federal recognized tribes should be treated the same. And I strongly encourage the subcommittee to quickly move to mark up a clean carcerary fix. Either Mr. Cole's bill 249, and I'll say Mr. Cole's bill because he's in the majority and I totally embrace his bill, or if you wanted to, my bills, H.R. 407, to restore fairness under the Indian Reorganization Act among all tribal nations. Tribes need fair access to rebuild their land base that promotes their well-being. And when we strengthen Indian country, we strengthen our entire nation. So, Mr. Chairman, thank you for the courtesy of being here today.
I thank the good lady, and I can assure you that this hearing is a hearing to hear for a solution to the carcerary question about trust lands. I am a little frustrated, for those in the audience, from the National Congress of American Indians. Little communication, no phone calls, but a lot of fire and gasoline on an issue that shouldn't have been an issue. I don't appreciate it. I know who's involved, and if you want to have an open access to this chairmanship, as long as I sit here, I will be chairman. I'm going to suggest we play ball straight. This is not to start an issue or try to destroy the effects of this committee. I hope everybody understands that. I do not forgive very well when it comes to taking and destroying the aspects of this committee. Not once I have not served the American Indian Alaska Natives. Now bring me in the question is, does yourself a disservice? And when I do not, and I'm not happy, you're not going to be happy either. With that, the committee, the witnesses have been seated. You all know the rules, and I'm usually pretty lenient about time, but not too lenient. And so I'm going to suggest that, Mr. Kevin, good to see you again. I was good to you last time. I hope to be good to you this time. I want you to make comments on this hearing and what you'd like to bring to light in the committee and the wisdom you have you bring to this great office that you serve in. You're up.
Thank you, Chairman. You're very kind. Let me say that tribal nations sacrificed a lot to make way for the creation of the greatest democracy the world has ever known. The U.S. owes tribes for their sacrifice. As Mr. Cole said, during the 50 years of the so-called allotment era, tribes lost approximately 90 million acres of land. In 1934, Congress turned away from the shameful and disastrous policy of allotment, which robbed the Indian people of their lands, including Mr. Cole's ancestors' lands. The New Deal Congress showed incredible leadership and passed the Indian Reorganization Act, known as the IRA. The IRA addressed the legacy of allotment in part and recognized tribal sacrifice by giving the Department of the Interior the power to restore some of the land that had been taken over the previous 50 years. Interior has exercised this power for over 80 years, eight decades, without any problems. Of course, we've not succeeded in restoring 90 million acres of land, and tribes know that this is not necessarily possible. Some eggs cannot be unscrambled without harming other people. But we've provided justice in a small way by helping tribes acquire lands for agriculture and housing and public buildings such as schools and justice centers, as Ms. McCollum mentioned, as well as for economic development. Land into trust furthers economic development and expands tribal sovereignty. President Obama recognizes that. Secretary Sally Jewell recognizes it too. Now, admittedly, Interior's power to take land into trust was used only rarely during the previous presidential administration. But when President Obama came into office, he made restoring tribal homelands one of his highest priorities. So Interior dusted off the power and began taking land into trust again. Since 2009, we've taken nearly 300,000 acres of land into trust for well more than 100 tribes. 300,000 acres is roughly 470 square miles of land. Of course, 300,000 acres pales in comparison to the land that was lost, but it provides a small measure of justice for tribes who sacrificed so much. 300,000 acres is a success for Indian country, but it is also a success for any American citizen who has lingering doubts about the morality of the worst aspects of manifest destiny and the injustices that were sometimes perpetrated to create this great nation. This hearing looks like an attempt to chart a far different path than the 1934 Congress. That was then, this is now. Just three weeks ago, members of this committee raised constitutional questions about the legitimacy of the tribes that have been recognized by the executive branch and the Department of the Interior. Those questions were directed immediately at the 17 tribes recognized through the Part 83 process and other tribes through the memorandum circulated before the meeting. But the executive branch has recognized literally dozens and dozens of tribes throughout history, and this committee has basically raised questions about all of them, and that makes them nervous. Today, this committee launches a much broader attack on Indian country. The title of this hearing asserts that there are inadequate standards for trust land acquisition, and in the hearing memo for this committee hearing, there are questions raised about the legitimacy of the administration's power to take land into trust for tribes. And this potentially affects all tribes, and I agree with Mr. Cole that no tribes would like that to happen. I want to thank the committee for its honesty. If anyone wonders about your motives for holding these hearings, the committee has provided these memorandum for both hearings in which the benefits of tribal sovereignty are questioned. You've made plain your concerns about tribal governments, and you've not hidden your prejudices, and I think I respect that, because although I disagree with you, and I'm glad you're not running from your convictions, a representative democracy only works if people are honest about what their views are. That gives voter a clear choice, and the voters need a clear choice. So voters now can determine whether they prefer that vision of Indian country presented in the memo by this committee or President Obama's vision for Indian country. Tribes face tragic problems: high suicide rates among Native youth, high rates of domestic violence, high rates of sexual assaults of women and even children. Over the long term, land in a trust gives tribes more tools to address those tragedies. I worry that your vision returns us to what some believe are the darkest days of Indian policy. You may have been told that land in a trust is only about gaming, but in 6+ years, out of 1,900 applications for land in a trust approved, fewer than 20 of those out of 1,900 were for gaming. Most were for agriculture, followed by infrastructure such as schools and detention centers, then for non-gaming economic development, and then housing. Let me speak not just to the leadership, but the other members of this committee. 3 weeks ago, when a fusillade was launched toward Indian country, the other members of this committee who were present said nothing. That worries Indian country a great deal. Now, I was caught off guard by the tone of that hearing, and I suspect maybe you were too. I understand that. But all of us have a stake in this. President Kennedy once quoted an Englishman who said, "The only thing necessary for evil to succeed is for good people to do nothing." It's on your conscience and on mine if this attack to Indian country is allowed to succeed. I don't intend to stand idly by and let it happen on my watch, and I ask the same of you. I am here today to let the committee know that Indian country will not shy away from a righteous battle. If we did, we would no longer exist. If history proves anything, it proves that Indian tribes are fighters. I respectfully ask you not to take this path. If you take this path against the people of Indian country, the Obama administration will be standing shoulder to shoulder with tribes and tribal organizations as they fight you on this. Thank you for your time, Chairman.
I thank you, Mr. Kevin. I mean, we'll discuss this a little later on, too. Mr. Knockout, Councilman of the Tribe of Rhode Island.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
United South, Eastern Tribes, etc.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, members of the subcommittee. Thank you for this opportunity to provide comments on trust land acquisition in the Indian Reorganization Act of 1934. I am here today in my capacity as Vice President of the United South and Eastern Tribes, USET, an intertribal organization representing 26 federally recognized tribes from Texas across to Florida and up to Maine. I should note also that I serve as First Councilman and Ambassador for the Narragansett Tribe, as well as First Vice President for National Congress of American Indians. Before I proceed further, I would like to present the members of the subcommittee with a gift. Given to the clerk, which is an exhibition book from the Indian Museum's exhibit on treaty making process. This is a fantastic exhibit which explores the very issues and relationships which led to the IRA. I believe that you and your staff will enjoy this exhibit and find that it provides helpful context for today's discussion. USET believes that the greatest issue with regard to Indian Reorganization Act, the IRA, is not one of inadequate standards under statute, but rather the rigorous standards imposed by regulation that could be streamlined to better implement the important policies of the IRA. Looking back, we find that the IRA was enacted in the furtherance of policy goals which are still applicable today, and that it was designed to provide powerful tools to address problems that persist even now. One of the highest priorities is the need to rebuild our tribal land base following nearly 200 years of systematic dispossession from which Indian country is still reeling. The size of the United States is 2.3 billion acres, which was once all of Indian country. By 1887, tribal land holdings had fallen to 138 million acres. That year, Congress passed the General Allotment Act, GAA. In a memorandum to Congress upon the consideration of the IRA, its primary architect, Commissioner of Indian Affairs John Collier, wrote, "Through sales by government of this fictitious designated surplus land, through sales by allottees after the trust period had ended or had been terminated by the Administrative Act, and through sales by the government of airship lands, virtually mandatory under the Allotment Act. Through these three methods, the total of Indian land holdings have been cut from 138 million acres in 1887 to 48 million acres in 1934. One half of those acres were found to be unusable. Of course, Indian country's dramatic loss of land had an inverse effect of providing extraordinary gain for non-Indians in the surrounding state, county, and local jurisdictions who took control over the 90 million acres. The IRA was a specific congressional response to the impoverishing effect of the GAA and other past policies that had the effect of seizing Indian lands. While the goals of the intent of the IRA remain valid and relevant in current world, in many ways, the IRA has yet to be fully implemented. With respect to land, only a small portion of the 90 million acres that were lost following the enactment of the GAA have been repatriated, less than 10%. And that does not account for the countless millions of acres lost prior to 1887 under different but equally damaging state and federal policies and actions. Ironically, the very lands largely stolen from tribes that tribes seek to put in trust under the IRA, tribes have had to purchase back. Tribes are using their own resources in order to make a federal policy designed to undo the damage of prior federal policies work as intended. The tools of the IRA are now needed now as much as ever before. These tools include the broad and flexible authority to acquire land and trust for Indian tribes wherever feasible and appropriate. Various efforts to challenge the constitutionality of the IRA have been rejected by at least five circuit courts. Consistent with the nation-building intent of the IRA, legitimate considerations, including issues raised by the counties, can be addressed through the administrative process. They do not require statutory change. As tribal leaders, we have the same responsibility that you have and that state and county officials have, which is to work to provide for the needs of our people, including addressing housing, economic, and many other needs. The IRA is critical to our ability to rebuild our homelands. Indeed, that was its fundamental purpose. I thank the committee for taking the time to conduct this oversight hearing. The importance of the IRA and its trust land provisions to tribe stay cannot be overstated. With regard to the Kachiri fix, we thank you, Chairman Young, and other members of the subcommittee for your steadfast support. We know that you have led efforts in the past to bring this to a hearing. I stand here today as a leader of tribal nations, ready to have a hearing on H.R. 249-407. We are ready, as Indian country, to have the Kachiri fix done once and for all. And I ask that that be considered as the next hearing that brings us into town. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I thank you for keeping time, and I can assure you, Mr. Cole and Mr. McCollum and the rest of this committee, we're going to seek a solution to the carcerary fix that's been around too long. It is a challenge, as there's some people who don't agree with this, as you know. So we're going to try to do that. Next is Lori Stimson, Tribal Attorney General. What's this? Why don't you write these out? Porch Creek, Band Creek Indians of Alabama, and Malmore in Alabama. You're up.
Good afternoon, Chairman Young, Ranking Member Ruiz, and members of the subcommittee. My name is Lori Stinson. I'm the Attorney General for the Porch Band of Creek Indians and an enrolled tribal member. Thank you for this opportunity to testify today. With me are Councilman Keith Martin, former Chairman Eddie Tullis, and Tribal Elder Billy Smith. Like the Muscogee Creek, we are descendants of the original Creek Nation that once covered most of Alabama and Georgia. In the early 1800s, the Trail of Tears saw many Creek families removed from our lands. What is now the Porch Creek remained. We settled in a remote part of southeast Alabama, where we maintained our existence as an autonomous, distinct tribal community. We worked on other people's farms, and we did any kind of job that was available, and we shared what we had with each other. During the Reagan administration, the U.S. formally acknowledged that the tribe existed since historical times. That formal recognition was the culmination of decades of work by the elders here with me today and others who have passed on. It is with regret that I first must address the written testimony that was submitted to you by the Muscogee Creek Nation. they have brought an intertribal dispute into a forum despite pending litigation. In 1980, the tribe learned that part of Hickory Ground Town, which had been a massive creek settlement, was for sale. The area had been farmed and built on first by Creeks and subsequently by centuries of white settlers. Today, it's the site of modern-day Wetumpka, as you can see in the photo. Back then, we had few resources, but we knew the land was important. And because of our shared cultural ties to the Muscogee Creeks, we reached out and asked them to jointly acquire the property. But they did not respond to our requests. So we had no choice but to go it alone. Even so, for many, Even so, for many years, we continued to consult with the Muscogee on how to preserve the area. We notified them after the discovery of a historical ceremonial ground and brought in a team of experts to ensure the preservation and protection of any artifacts found. And even though we are a sovereign nation and it is our land, we presented a series of plans for cultural and historic preservation, but the Muscogee rejected everything. Ultimately, despite years of meetings and effort on our part, Porch Creek and Muscogee have never reached a consensus. So we did what we believed was right. The photo shows our preservation of the ceremonial grounds. The opportunity to take this land into trust has allowed us to build our tribal community for our elders and for our future porch generations. This brings me finally to the point of this hearing, to encourage the subcommittee to fulfill its trust responsibilities to all tribes and to support community rebuilding through the land into trust process. Our tribal government operations provide police and fire protection, education, health care, housing, transportation, elder services, social services, cultural education, and much more. Many of these services and facilities are located on our tribal trust lands, allowing us to provide for our enrolled members and our neighbors. Looking at the screen above, you'll see photos of recently constructed infrastructure that provided much needed services for our community. We are proud of these facilities. They include the Buford L. Rowland Health Clinic, named after former Chairman Rowland, who dedicated his life to improving health care for all of Indian Country, our assisted living facility, and our early learning center. We have more fee land than we have trust land, and many of the services we provide to our community and our neighbors are located on fee property, including our fire station that serves Porch Creek and the surrounding community, and Magnolia Branch Wildlife Reserve, which is over 6,500 acres and provides recreational and camping opportunities to the entire region. It's the tribe's dream to place these lands into trust. And for this reason, Porch Creek shares the position of most in Indian Country, that Congress should work to ensure that tribes can take land into trust without undue delays or burdensome requirements. We agree with and support the views of USAID expressed here today. The IRA has worked and can accomplish so much more. The land into trust standards are not inadequate. And after reading this subcommittee's hearing memo, our tribe is concerned that rather than addressing the difficulties that tribes have in acquiring trust property, Congress may be considering adding additional barriers. Our tribe, like many tribes and many tribal organizations, want to work with Congress to ensure federally recognized Indian tribes can continue to rebuild communities through the land into trust process. Trust lands revive jobs and encourage needed investment into local communities. Like Porch Creek, many tribes are the economic engines for their rural areas. Our tribe employs thousands of area residents and regularly makes significant amounts of charitable contributions to the surrounding communities. This committee's priority should be to ensure that the land into trust rules work effectively and efficiently, and is to assist tribes in their efforts to rebuild communities and not make it harder. I have a letter here with me today that I would like to submit from Auburn University detailing our preservation efforts in Wetumpka for the record. Again, thank you for this opportunity, and I'm prepared to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you very much. I believe the next one is Brenda Golden. Policy Allen is a self-governance officer, testified on behalf of the Muscogee Creek Nation of Oklahoma.
Good afternoon, committee members, Chairman Young, Dr. Ruiz. Thank you all for having the Muscogee Creek Nation here today. As you know, we are the fourth largest federally recognized tribe in the United States, but our homelands were in Alabama originally before we were forcibly removed. We are one of many tribes that maintain our cultural and traditional and our ceremonies when we moved here from Alabama. And we are here today to support the carcerary fix in its entirety, except for an exclusion for the Porch Band Creek of Indians. Imagine, if you will, that at some point the lands of Arlington Cemetery were turned over to a group of people in Virginia who petitioned under the guise that they were going to protect and preserve the cemetery, only to a year later start digging up the bodies of our patriots, the people who fought for our country, and built a gambling facility on top of that property. That is the exact way that we feel about our ancestors who have been buried and dug up in Wetumpka, Alabama. But let me go back for just a minute and talk about in 1830, when our ancestors were forced to leave Alabama, the grounds of Wetumpka, called Oje Abova, which is known as Hickory Ground, was our historic capital. And not only that, it was a ceremonial ground and a sacred place for our people to have traditional meetings, and it was sacred to our people and sacred to the whole Muscogee Creek Nation. The National Register of Historic Places recognized this, and as I have indicated in our written testimony, the setting there met many criteria to be placed on the National Historic of Registry of Historical Places. Not only is it a religious property, it's a burial ground, and it also holds historical significance. And so when the Porch Band Creek petitioned to have this land with federal grant funds to protect and preserve, we supported that effort, only to have that trust destroyed, because within a year they were digging up our ancestors' graves, putting the bones somewhere that we still don't know where they are at, and building a 26-story casino on top of the ceremonial ground. The newly recognized Porch Band Creek renounced their citizenship in the Muscogee Creek Nation when we were forced to remove to Oklahoma. Upon our removal, our ceremonial leaders carried fire to our new lands from Hickory Ground. We carried part of our ancestors' spirits with us, but we left part behind in care of and in trust of others in the area to uphold for us. In short, the Muscogee Creek Nation has asked the Department of Interior National Park Service, has asked the Porch Band Creek, and has asked others in Congress to help us to uphold our lands and our spirits, ancestor spirits in our homelands. Today, we wholeheartedly support a carcerary fix with the exclusion of the Porch Band Creek's land, where the gaming facility is desecrating our ancestors' burial place. It is a common shared value and amongst all walks of life that those who are interred in a place should be left in peace and should be left in the care of those who are left behind. We ask that the Porch Band not be financially rewarded for taking taxpayer money to purchase land and profit individually and exponentially with a small tribe that can lobby and pay their way into getting trust land. So we ask for you today to take into consideration an exclusion of that land and to also give us an opportunity in the future, those of us who were removed from other lands, when this may come up again because many tribes are not in their original homelands. We would like meaningful consultation before trust land is taken into trust with any group, tribe, or Indian with the disposition of that land when it is up for trust consideration. We believe that trust regulations are rigorous and in fact believe that in some cases we have many years that we go without getting our land into trust than when it should have been from the start. So again, We thank you for allowing us to be here, and I send my apologies on behalf of Principal Chief George Tiger, who couldn't make it today. Thank you, Meadow.
You don't have to apologize. I thought your presentation was well done. I'll let him know that, too, so keep that in mind. Next witness is Mr. David Rabbit, Supervisor of Sonoma County, California, on behalf of the California State Association of Counties.
Chairman Young, Ranking Member Ruiz, and members of the subcommittee, thank you for the opportunity to participate in today's hearing. My name is David Rabbit. I am an elected supervisor from Sonoma County, California, but the testimony that I am in delivering is on behalf of the California State Associations of Counties, commonly known as CSAC, which represents all 58 counties in the state of California. Within CSAC, I serve as vice chair of the Housing, Land Use, and Transportation Committee, and I also co-chair of CSAC's Indian Gaming Working Group. Before I get to the heart of my comments, I'd like to reaffirm CSAC's absolute respect for the authority of federally recognized Indian tribes. We also reaffirm our support for the right of tribes to self-governance and recognize the need for tribes to preserve their heritage and to pursue economic self-reliance. I'd also like to clear up at the onset any potential misconception that counties are somehow not interested in seeing Congress address the implications of the Supreme Court's Cartieri versus Salazar decision. On the contrary, CSAC recognizes the disparity and inequity caused by the court's decision and believes federally recognized tribes should be placed on equal footing relative to the opportunity to have land taken into trust. At the same time, it is incumbent upon Congress to fix the longstanding systemic defects in the Department of Interior's broken fee-to-trust process. To be crystal clear, we believe that any Cartieri fix, that is, any legislation that would restore the Interior Secretary's authority to take land into trust for tribes must be coupled with much-needed, long-overdue reforms in the federal government's deeply flawed trust land decision-making process. Unfortunately, a so-called clean Cartieri fix would do nothing to repair the underlying problems in the trust land system and would only serve to exasperate and perpetuate the inherent conflict and fundamental flaws of the current process, a process, incidentally, that is broken for all parties, tribes and local governments alike. Existing federal laws and regulations simply fail to address the off-reservation impacts of tribal land development. County governments and the people we serve are the ones most heavily impacted by fee-to-trust decisions. Trust acquisitions are often increased demands for law enforcement, fire protection, health and social services, transportation, water, and other resources provided by counties without providing any mitigation for the burdens created. Not only is mitigation ignored in the free-to-trust process, a county's capacity to address the impacts is reduced by eliminating the land from the local tax base. Nonetheless, although trust acquisitions often result in significant off-reservation impacts, the Department of Interior does not provide impacted local governments and communities with sufficient notice or meaningful opportunity to comment regarding fee-to-trust applications. California counties are not the only ones who have identified these critical deficiencies in the trust land process. A recent article in the Pepperdine Law Review recounted a quantitative analysis of all 111 fee-to-trust decisions by the Pacific Region BIA office between 2001 and 2011. The analysis found that BIA granted 100% of the proposed acquisition requests, and in no case did any Section 151 factor weigh against approval of an application. The analysis further found that because of the lack of clear guidance and objective criteria, Pacific Region BIA decisions avoid substantive analysis in favor of filler considerations and boilerplate language. The result is a broken process in which community concerns are ignored or downplayed, applications are rubber-stamped, and tribes and local governments are forced into unnecessary and unproductive conflict. Even critics of the study who argue with the results do not dispute the failure of meaningful application to the current standards and boilerplate language acceptance. These same conclusions were reached in the 2006 Government Accounting Office report to Congress on the fee-to-trust process, which determined that the regulations do not provide a clear, uniform, and objective approach, and instead provide wide discretion to the BIA without any guidelines for making decisions. There has been no meaningful change since that GAO study was issued. The federal process is flawed in that it does not provide an avenue for tribes to engage in good faith discussions regarding mitigation of environmental impacts of tribal development, nor is there any incentive for tribes to enter into enforceable mitigation agreements with local governments. In fact, the BIA will not even facilitate such decisions, as it believes the trust responsibility to tribes prevents it from engaging local governments in such efforts. It should be noted that an approach that encourages intergovernmental agreements between tribes and local governments affected by FETA trust applications is required and working well under the California state gaming compacts. In Sonoma County, we just entered into a comprehensive intergovernmental agreement to create a over 500-acre homeland for the Litton Band of Pomo Indians and are supporting legislation by Congressman Huffman to take that land into trust. Not only does such a collaborative approach offer the opportunity to streamline the application process, it can also help to ensure the success of the tribal project within the local community. The establishment of a trust land system that incentivizes intergovernmental agreements between tribes and local governments is at the heart of CSAC's FETA trust reform recommendations, which has been submitted to this committee and our entire congressional delegation. And I know my time is limited, so I'd just like to really say three things. CSAC really encourages you to at least have us not have to do a Freedom of Information Act request to find out if there's a trust land application in effect, that we ask for 20-day notice at a minimum up front so that we can engage in a conversation to make sure that we have that communication, that relationship being built along the way, so that when the final application is through, over which now has a 30-day notification period, if that could be stretched to 90 days, I think that we would all be much better boat, because we wouldn't end up in court over that. And I think finally, again, what we're asking for is to somehow incentivize those intergovernment agreements not to dictate what happens on the land, but to dictate how the mitigations occur to the development on the land on the off-reservation impacts. It's worked well in California, and it's worked well in our county, and we think it can work well for the entire country. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Rabbit. Next is Christian McMillan, Department of History, University of Virginia. You're up. Put the mic in front of you.
Good afternoon, Chairman Young, Ranking Member Ruiz, and members of the subcommittee. My name is Christian McMillan. I'm Professor of History at the University of Virginia. Thank you for the opportunity to testify. The Indian Reorganization Act of 1934, as many have already said, was a monumental shift in Indian history. It was the culmination of nearly two decades of Indian and non-Indian efforts to change how the United States managed Indian affairs. Until the passage of the IRA, the cornerstone of Indian policy had been the General Allotment Act, an act responsible for allowing approximately 90 million acres of land to fall out of Indian hands. All involved in drafting the IRA intended it to end allotment and promote tribal self-determination. Recognizing that allotment had been devastating for tribes, the Bureau of Indian Affairs, in drafting the IRA, and Congress, in passing the IRA, elected to end that practice. At the same time, it was clear to everyone that allotment had left many tribes either landless or in possession of an insufficient land base. For this reason, beyond simply stopping allotment in order to prevent further land loss, those who drafted and passed the IRA intended it to be a mechanism by which tribes could acquire additional land. That purchasing more land for tribes is a major goal of the IRA is evident in the Senate and House reports on the legislation. Both reports address the need to purchase land for landless Indians and or for those tribes whose current land base was inadequate. As the Senate report put it, quote, to meet the needs of landless Indians and Indians of and of individuals and tribes whose land holdings are insufficient for self-support, Section 5 of the bill authorizes the purchase of lands by the Secretary of the Interior. The original bill was made up of 60 sections. The final act was whittled down to 19. The IRA in its final form contained, according to the IRA's co-sponsor, one of its co-sponsors, Representative Edgar Howard, quote, those features most urgently needed, and eliminates controversial features upon which agreement could not be reached. And one of those fundamental features was Section 5. Section 5 was essential because Congress, again according to Representative Howard, quote, must go further than ending allotment and actually restore some of the lost lands to the Indians. Section 5 sets up a land acquisition program to provide land for Indians who have no sufficient, who have no land or insufficient land. For Howard, this was a wise investment. To him, the best way to make Indian people self-sufficient and thus not be the burden of the government was to provide them the resources necessary to thrive economically, and a sufficient land base was essential. The Secretary of the Interior put Section 5 to work very quickly after the passage of the IRA. Each year, from 1936 to 1939, for example, the Department of the Interior appropriated $1 to $1.5 million to purchase land under Section 5. The appropriation from 1936, for instance, was being used to purchase land for, quote, 32 different bands, tribes, or groups, end quote. The program was deemed essential for the economic well-being of Indians. Since first being put into action in 1936, almost immediately after the passage of the IRA, Section 5 of the IRA has been used to restore some of the land lost to allotment and as an aid in fostering self-determination and self-government. From both a brief review of the legislative history and a look at how it was implemented following the passage of the IRA, the intent of Congress regarding Section 5 is clear. As a historian who has spent considerable time working on this period of Indian history, American Indian history, I've written two books on the 1920s, 30s, and 40s, I am very confident, as I'm sure almost any other historian would be, in my assessment of the intentions of Congress and the Bureau of Indian Affairs regarding the aims of the Indian Reorganization Act generally and of Section 5 specifically. This period of American Indian history was like no other. Never had so many fundamental ways of doing things been changed, and never had the BIA and Congress acted so decisively in favor of Indian self-determination and well-being. Thank you for allowing me to testify.
Thank you, sir, for your testimony. I'm going to ask one question, I'm going to refer to you. Kevin, could you explain how the IRA delegated land into trust authority to the department?
You bet. I think the professor just laid out the context for that, and basically it allowed the secretary to take land into trust for tribes. We have, and the goal was to restore land to tribes, and we have characterized that. We've interpreted that delegation of authority, and we've channeled it pretty narrowly. We've created a set of regs, the 151 regulations, that put requirements on us as to how we go about taking that land into trust, providing notice to counties and local governments, for example. And I understand from Mr. Rabbit that it may not be, adequate notice from his standpoint, but we certainly hear from counties and local governments. We hear from interested parties. We recently amended those regulations about a year ago, in late 2013, actually, to add additional notice for when we take land into trust. So. We've got a set of regs in place that have worked really well for a long time.
I've been through this a lot. I need a list from you, Kevin, on the applications for taking land into trust, those that were accepted and those were denied. I want to be able to put them side by side, because I think what we're looking for is a uniformity. We just heard from two ladies here, one on one side, one on the other side, and yet the secretary took the land into trust of historical rights. Were they heard from? Was there any objection at that time? If we had a uniform system, it seems to me to save a lot of these arguments. Instead of having a secretary make different rules and different regulations, I want that list from you. I've been a critic of the reservation shopping. That's my biggest thing. What does a tribe, or do you have a right to say they're shopping for a casino land in California without consulting the counties? That's not what we're looking for here. I just, you understand where my criticism, if it is a relation to the tribe, land in proximity, if there's no other land available, then it ought to be, the county ought to know is, in fact, immediately, is this land being purchased to be put in trust for a casino? That's not happened. You've had a discretion to ignore it. So what would be your answer to that?
Well, Mr. Chairman, we actually do not disapprove very many land into trust applications. I agree with that. But let me tell you, there's no deadline on us to act. So what happens is, if there's one that has problems with it, we often never act, or we ask the tribe to withdraw it. And so I can't give you a list of disapprovals. There won't be a very long list.
Now, wait a minute. Don't tell me you can't if there is one. Well, you had your lawyer behind you, and you're a lawyer. This is a committee. Now, I want to know who's applied and who was accepted and who was not, and why I want to look at it is I want to put them side by side and see, was the discretion of a secretary, just not you, that made that decision without and giving it to another one over here. That's why there should be some uniformity in this system, so each body's playing on the same ground. I know of one tribe did everything right.
and wasn't accepted. I know another tribe that didn't do everything right and got accepted. It happened was under your administration. Well, I'm just saying, why not have a uniform? Let us pass a law so every tribal member in here has the right, knowing full well why it's objected and why it's accepted. Not have one tribe get it and the other tribe not. What's wrong with that?
Well, tribes have different needs. Every tribe is unique.
Not different. Then you're making that decision.
Well, the reason
I say you don't have that right, the Congress does. So I say I want to write a law, and this isn't future. I'm not talking about the past, so anybody get excited in the audience. I'm talking about the future. Like I say, you only got 17 months left. I don't know who's going to be there. I don't want to have you make one decision, have the next guy make a different decision on different criteria. That's not fair to the tribes. Why would you object to that?
Well, because there's no tribe that's asking for that, Chairman. There's not a single tribe that wants you to pass a law that...
Wait a minute. That's not true. There are tribes that say we need to know why we were turned down. Why did one tribe, the other tribe got it, and we didn't? Because of the discretion of the Secretary, the BIA. And as far as you not giving me the information, don't ever cross me that way, Kevin. If I ask you anything, you will give me that information.
Well, I'm just telling you what you're going to get. And
I have a freedom of information myself and subpoena you.
Chairman, you know I will give you information if you ask for it. But what I'm just telling you is that there's not going to be a long list of disapprovals. You said prepare the approvals and the disapprovals side by side. And we don't have a long list of disapprovals, frankly. But we've done a few disapprovals, but generally what happens is the tribe just withdraws when we tell them, look, this application's got problems. So there aren't two set of identical decisions that one stacks approvals and one stacks disapprovals. The disapprovals don't exist in decision form so much because the tribe has often withdrawn those.
All right, we'll continue that discussion because I still say if we had a uniform criteria, it'd be beneficial to the tribes that want new lands put into trust.
I encourage you to ask if they think that's beneficial and be guided by tribes. That's what tribal self-determination means.
Are we going to have a balanced deal? You said reject a deal. If I get enough people say we want a different system?
Well,
the lady says talking about hiring lobbyists, et cetera, and I know that's true. We pass more in trust lands than anybody else, as Congress itself. But this would put it to a criteria where there would be a uniform way to do it. And my time's up. Go ahead.
Chairman, I'm going to change the order a little, if that's okay with you. And Ranking Member Grijalva,
he left.
Be next.
He do that.
No, he's still here. And then I'll ask Norma.
Okay. Go ahead. You're recognized.
Yes.
A couple of quick questions, Mr. Washburn. Well, some may focus on only some tribes that are impacted by carcieri, aren't all tribes in some way impacted by the ruling and what the department has to review for those that carcieri purposes when taking lands into trust because of that ruling, after that ruling? I think the impact, even today we hear it's a limited impact, but my sense of it, my understanding of it, this is... It's a full impact on all of Indian country.
Yes, Mr. Ranking Member, absolutely. It does fall on all tribes because we have to do the criteria analysis now for every single tribe before we take land into trust for them and make sure that they meet the terms of criteria. And so it does actually fall on all tribes, at least initially. And then what happens is once we've found that a tribe does not have a particular problem with Kacheri, those tribes are still affected because we've got lawyers, and some of them are in this room, that have to now focus on analysis for other tribes. And we don't have the bandwidth. We've got a Full Employment for Lawyers Act, basically, is what Kacheri is. So we've got a lot of lawyers that are having to look at every single new trust land application to make sure Kacheri does not pose a problem. So
yeah, and I've been reading lately that they do pretty good. The other issue is the 151 process, Mr. Washburn. You know, IRA might be silent on the standards, but that 151 process has to conform to some standards, rather than saying that it's subjective, as we've heard. Some do, some don't. could just briefly, because I have a couple other questions, limited time on the 151.
Yes, Mr. Ranking Member. Let me just say that the U.S. Supreme Court has pointed to our 151 regulations and said that they seem to do a pretty good job to be sensitive to all the concerns that others have in the process and gives them an opportunity to participate. So even the court that gave us Kacheri also said that our 151 regs are a good process and a sensitive process. So there is certainly standards in our 151 regs that can be applied here. Thank you.
Ms. Stinson, if I may. First of all, I don't believe it's wise to use hearings, congressional hearings, to discuss tribal disputes, but that seems to be the practice. But now that you've heard the testimony from Ms. Golden from the Muscogee Creek Nation, is there anything you would like to respond to, in particular the no cultural affiliation implication and the desecration burial grounds comment?
Sure. I agree with you. This is not the forum. This is impending litigation. But you've heard what the efforts we went through to consult with Muscogee. I encourage you to read the letter that I entered into the record today. It's from the archaeologist from Auburn University, Dr. Cottier, and it goes through the efforts that we have gone through to preserve and protect, and we've taken the utmost care and respect in doing so, and I would encourage you to read that.
And the Portinias are prepared to let the litigation run its course as opposed to...
Yes, sir.
Okay. If I may, Ms. Golden, real quickly, in 1983, the Muscogee Creek Nation passed an ordinance essentially saying establishing a government-to-government relationship with the Porch Band of Creek Indians, and a distinct and separate band, and recognized it, and went on to say it disclaims all interest in internal affairs of the Porch Band effective March 24th, 1882. So it would certainly seem to pass the cartiary threshold that we're looking at 1882. Any response to that ordinance, recognizing them, but yet the discussion today is about the limited recognition, if I may?
Yes, sir. Thank you. Our intent is not to discredit the recognition of the Porch Band Creek as descendants. Actually, they are properly recognized as descendants of our ancestors, which makes it even more egregious that they've dug up our ancestors' funerary remains and bones to build a casino on top of. We did support them in that effort because we believed at the time that they were going to...
Do you think that it should run, as I asked Ms. Tice, that let the litigation run its course as the arbitrator in this difference? Saying that you're in court on the issue as well?
We do have a court case, an ongoing court case. However, as with any litigation, we can't determine the outcome. Therefore, we are asking for your indulgence in excluding the Porch Band from profiting from...
I know. We have other cases before us where court decisions didn't go a certain way, and now we're legislating an overturning of that court decision. I think honoring that process, in my estimation, is... The way to go. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You're back.
Mr. Mumple.
Good afternoon. Couple things. Just my own personal thoughts on this as recognitions of tribes is really an important and significant undertaking with in the establishment of them, and it isn't just for eligibility for what the federal government might be involved with, but a determination that a tribe merits sovereign status, autonomous management of trust lands, and a special direct relationship with the federal government. The significance of recognition demands that a process remain stringent and thorough to ensure the proper respect is given to recognized tribes. Then what I'm also looking at, too, is our focus should be on what is current, like, for example, with the BIA, and what I view is the lowering of the bar for recognition and for off-reservation gaming we have great concerns about. not looking back to reexamine whether the status of recognized tribes should be reconsidered. So Secretary Washburn, the BIA has proposed, again, what I view as a pretty drastic lowering of the bar for recognition of tribes. And I also believe you've acted to take land into trust for gaming purposes in a manner that would negatively impact existing neighboring tribes. So we in Congress have a clearly defined role constitutionally in relationship with tribes, but the BIA's role is only that which Congress has defined. So, Secretary, would you describe for me what you believe the BIA's role in the trust land process really is, and does Congress need to more explicitly define and clarify that authority of the BIA so we don't have this dispute?
Congressman LaMalfa, I don't think it's unclear. In the Indian Gaming Regulatory Act of 1988, Congress said that they said generally you can't take land under trust for gaming after the passage of IGRA in 1988, but they included an exception for initial reservations. Presumably that is for tribes that are recognized after 1988. So it's clear. Congress has made it clear that it is okay in some circumstances to take land into trust for tribes that were not indeed recognized at the time of IGRA's passage in 1988. So there's no lack of clarity. You may disagree with it, but there's not a lack of clarity about it. Congress did that.
We've been through it. So, all right. Who would like to do the speaking for the Muscogee Nation? Would you, ma'am? Okay. Again, what we've heard here earlier is a pretty lengthy and contentious relationship with the Poarch Creek Band. And so I'm wondering, wouldn't it be better to address these concerns in court rather in front of us in Congress, continue that in court, because I don't think it's our appropriate role to try to tackle that here, ma'am.
As it applies to the IRA, the Indian Reorganization Act, for which the Poarch Band Creek were recognized under that act, the final rule that you, as Congress, could put a stop to their profiting from their illegal act, from their lack of displaying respect for our ancestors, and actually, you know, taking taxpayer money fraudulently. Congress has the power to address that, and that's what we are asking you to do.
Do you feel they're inappropriately recognized then?
We feel that appropriately they are members of the Creek Nation and should have applied for membership with our tribe. However, we supported their efforts for sovereign reasons to have a base in Alabama of our homelands.
Because my understanding is you had a measure that was passed in 1983 identifying Poarch Creek as a separate and distinct. So has the relationship changed in such that you no longer uphold that measure that you passed in 83?
I will agree with your assessment that the relationship has changed as such. And as I indicated earlier in my testimony, our descendants, which are called the Poarch Band Creek now, renounced their citizenship in order to stay behind in Alabama and not walk the thousands of miles that my ancestors were forced to do and died on the trail.
Ms. Chairman, I'll yield back.
You're up.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Contrary to some assertions made recently, the Dawes Act and the subsequent allotment policy of the United States, which robbed sovereign tribal nations of their ancestral lands, was and has always been racist and misguided. The allotment era was a disaster for Indian country and has caused significant and lasting hardships on these communities. Its legacy is very clear. Over 90 million acres passed out of Indian control, the lowest educational attainment of any population, and untold historical trauma still being felt today.
Recognizing the failures of allotment, Congress passed the Indian Reorganization Act in 1934, which explicitly authorized the Secretary of the Interior to take land into trust on behalf of tribes in order to provide them with a land base for their people and their economies. However, in the past few hearings in this subcommittee, we have heard some disconcerting claims regarding the alleged lack of legal or constitutional authority of the Secretary of Interior to take them into trust on behalf of tribal nations. It seems that it has also become common practice to air intertribal disagreements during these hearings. Divide and conquer has been the business of this subcommittee. There are a lot of problems in Indian country that this committee needs to address. Among those problems include a lack of economic opportunity, some of the highest suicide rates in the nation among Native youth, and inadequate access to accessible, high-quality health care. I would also add that we need to look into reasonable reforms to the land acquisition process as it relates to off-reservation gaming. These are the issues that we should be focusing on, and I hope that we can soon make real progress. Mr. Washburn, can you expand on the impact the Carceri decision has had on tribes, especially their effort to pursue projects beyond gaming, like housing for elders, community centers for the youth, and other opportunities?
Yes, madam, I'd be happy to. And I will tell you that Mr. Noka's tribe, the Narragansett tribe, is probably the best example. There are some partially built homes at the Narragansett tribe that are sitting empty, that's a community that needs housing, and they are just sitting empty because they were stopped in their tracks by the Carceri decision. And it's really mortifying that there are, you know, homes that have been built that are sitting empty when there are needs for elders to have housing because of this Supreme Court decision. And this Congress can fix that, and it should fix that. Thank you.
Regarding the land into trust process, can you explain in more detail how local governments and the public can weigh in on the impacts of their communities?
Absolutely. We actually actively seek their input whenever we get a land into trust application. We provide them notice. We provide the state and local governments notice when the application is complete and ask for their input. And we look at their input. And frankly, often they are very supportive because, often land into trust is for economic development or other needs that serve the same constituents that the city or the county serves.
Right.
So often they are very supportive. And in fact, far less than 10% of our land into trust applications are ever appealed. They don't take us to court. They raise their objections, and sometimes agreements are hammered out between the city or the county and the tribe. And usually they have a very good a relationship based on an agreement to provide services or provide police services or those sorts of things. So there's actually a lot of cooperation.
In 2013, you added additional notice. Can you tell me or explain to me what those additional notices include?
Yes, ma'am. They include, in part, what we did was we required publication in the newspaper. So we specifically notify the state and the local governments, but we also thought it would be good just to let other members of the public know, because sometimes other members of the public have interest or concerns. And so we put a requirement for publication in the newspaper. We also created a system where people can write into us if they've got a concern, and we will give them specific notice. If they've made themselves known as an interested party, we will let them know when a decision has been made. So if they would like to seek to challenge it, they may do so.
Time is up.
Thank you.
I just want to assure the lady this committee never divides and conquers. And whoever wrote that testimony, I want to talk to them a little later on. Well, you did a good job of slamming the chairman.
No, not you.
I said, that's good.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Representative Torres, for your comments. This is an important hearing.
It is.
Important hearing. As a follow-up to some statements that were made the last hearing that many have described as false and inappropriate, and also very important to discuss the land to trust issues. And as always, I want to offer a special thanks to the tribal leaders for traveling here to offer their views on this most important issue. The Indian Reorganization Act of 1934 is the cornerstone of federal Indian policy today, based upon the idea of promoting self-determination. It was enacted to undo the disastrous allotment and assimilation period of the 19th and early 20th century. The linchpin for that failed policy was the Dawes Act of 1887, which dictated the forced conversion of communally held tribal lands into parcels for individual Indian ownership. The government also took more than 90 million acres from tribes, nearly two-thirds of all reservation land, and gave it to settlers as surplus, most often without compensation to the tribes. The result of this injustice was devastating: extreme poverty, poor health, terrible living conditions, and a lack of economic opportunities for tribes, and the generational historical traumas felt as symptoms from members of the tribal communities as a result of this. It has also resulted in a terribly fractured land base, leaving some tribes landless and others with insufficient land. Thankfully, this policy was eventually abandoned in favor of one, self-determination and self-governance. It is clear from the historical record and embodied in the IRA that the purchase and return of land to the tribes was of paramount importance to restoring the tribal way of life. Section 5 of the IRA states that, quote, "The Secretary of the Interior is hereby authorized in his discretion to acquire through purchase, relinquishment, gift, exchange, or assignment any interest in lands, water rights, or surface rights to lands within or without existing reservations for the purpose of providing lands for Indians." So it really can't be any clearer. Congress gave specific authority to the Secretary of the Interior to acquire lands for the tribes. Some have claimed that Section 5 raises constitutional questions, but the courts have repeated and unequivocally rejected these arguments, and questioning the legal authority of a tribe to exist is just simply absurd. And let's clarify one more thing. Taking land into trust or recognizing tribes isn't all about casinos. The majority of land into trust applications are for gaming purposes, and let's remind ourselves that the majority of the living conditions of Native Americans throughout the nation live in substandard conditions. And that's why these are so important for us. And that's why we still have the lack of health, appropriate health outcomes, access, and economic development. That's why it's so important that we find ways to make it better, as the chairman suggested earlier as well. So this is land that Native Americans will help raise their children and ensure the well-being of their people. The integrity of this right should not even be called into question. And I think it's very clear where I stand on the carcieri fix. And I think that we do have a great opportunity. I appreciate the complexity and the difficulties. I'm very much advocating for us to work together to figure out how we can untangle those complexities and get it done this cycle once and for all. And we do have a couple of bills offered by Mr. Cole and another by Ms. McCollum that would amend the language of the IRA to establish the Secretary's authority to take land into trust for all tribes, simply reaffirming what the drafters of the IRA intended all along. In terms of local input, I have some concerns that in some water rights or taxations within Indian country issues that we've experienced around the country, some members of the tribe have not even been invited to the table to discuss those senior water rights. This is an example of how sometimes members of the tribal communities aren't even recognized and their rights aren't. So it would be difficulty to then go to those same people to say, we want land into trust or we want to be recognized. Can you give your consent for that? So I think, with the permission of the chairman, if I can ask just one question, and that is to, Mr. Noka, to your knowledge, have any tribes come to Congress to request amendments to the Indian Reorganization Act?
No, sir.
Okay. Thank you very much, and I yield back my time.
Mr. Malfa.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My previous questions, I gave a chance for Ms. Golden. Ms. Attorney General Stinson, a couple for you here. Could you describe to us the process the Poarch Creek went through in order to receive federal recognition as a tribe? You know, what sort of records or documents otherwise were required for that recognition?
Sure. It was like I mentioned earlier, it was a long, painstaking process that took many, many years, actually decades of work. We hired, wasn't actually hired at the time because we had no resources. An anthropologist by the name of Anthony Paredes was very, very interested in those creeks that remained in Alabama. And he came and he did a lot of research and he did a lot of anthropological work that took many, many, many years. They researched Bibles. They did tons of oral interviews. We were very, very fortunate that in our community, the local Episcopal Church had kept very, very good records. Because unfortunately, in a poor Alabama community, records probably weren't things that were very valued, but the Episcopal Church valued those records. And that was part of the process that we used for federal recognition. And like I said, it took many, many years, and we went through very, very stringent standards and met those standards.
Okay. So, of course, the Muskogee have expressed serious concerns over the level of respect provided to the lands that they feel connected to as well. What sort of actions have the Poarch Creek taken on these lands in terms of preservation, restoration, et cetera?
Sure. I think you saw earlier a picture of the ceremonial grounds, which are uncovered in about 2005, and we took great effort to preserve those. In fact, I think we had had many conversations with them prior to that, and I think they even sent observers to watch the recovering of the ceremonial grounds. We've also preserved, it's a 34-acre track, and we're preserving the north part of the track had never been touched or had not been touched in many, many years. It has much timber on it, and we have committed to preserving that, and we've also set aside, I mentioned Magnolia Branch, it's a wildlife preserve, and we set aside a number of acres in there to preserve as well.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Chairman, I know we're running short on time. I'll yield back. Thank you.
I thank the lady. It was never intent for these hearings to try to amend the IRA. But there is a Supreme Court decision in Carcier. And that's really what we're trying to solve here. And I do again say that I want to thank the witnesses, but that's what we're working on. And eventually we have to have this if we're ever going to get a Carcier bill out of this committee or any other committee. It goes back to the ruling of the court. And I still would like to have a uniform, before this is done, a uniform way that every tribe knows exactly what they have to do without the discretion of the secretary. I've been under, now I believe, 10 or 11 secretaries, Mr. Washburn, and none of them had the same idea or the same decision. So that's something we have to work on. Meeting's adjourned.
Thank you.